Welcome to Hydrogeology 101, Pumping Tests. Today I'd like to talk about the Dupuy-Forsham equation for groundwater flow to pumping wells in unconfined aquifers under steady state conditions. In our previous video we looked at confined aquifers and we had a look at the TEAM equation, and I think you'll remember that the aquifer doesn't change in thickness, so that means that in confined aquifers, our transmissivity is constant throughout the aquifer. In unconfined situations, it's a bit different because the top of our saturated zone is the same as the water table, which declines as we reach our pumping well. What this means is that our aquifer thickness is changing, and that means that the transmissivity is also decreasing as we approach our pumping well. And that is why our equation, which is the Dupuy-Forsham equation, looks a little bit different than the TEAM equation. And it basically states that the discharge Q at this well here is pi times K times by the head squared at the outer boundary minus the head squared at the inner boundary, all divided by the log n of the outer radius divided by the inner radius. Let's use this equation in a practical example. We're going to have a look at the Kabul Basin in Afghanistan. This is a dry area with a lot of recharge from irrigation, so it could apply to other parts of the world as well. We're going to develop a well field in an irrigated area, and we're going to assume that the aquifer is 30 meters thick, composed of gravel, which has a hydraulic conductivity of 100 meters squared per day and a specific yield of 20%. First thing we do is we draw a little conceptual model. K is 100 meters per day, thickness here 30 meters, specific yield 20%. Aha! Did you notice? We don't actually need to know the specific yield because we're dealing with steady state, in which case storativity is not important. Just seeing if you're awake. Okay, our first question. If we pump the well at 50 liters per second, what is the radius of influence of the well, which means the maximum extent of the cone of depression under steady state conditions? What we need to do first of all is to calculate the recharge rate. Call it R in meters per day. Recharge rate is the amount of water which is recharging the aquifer from above. If we go to Hanover to the German Geological Survey, we'll find this report by Böck 1971 on the groundwater resources of the city of Kabul. So this is quite a long time ago, but what is interesting is that he noticed that seepage through irrigation channels has been found to be considerable. So this is based on studies done by the Russians in the 60s. And that a large amount of water is being lost through these irrigation channels. So in one case, we have 38% of the original water volume lost through the irrigation channel. And here we have two estimates, 750 liters per second on the right bank, 200 liters per second on the left bank. So that's like a cubic meter per second lost by seepage in the irrigation channel. So that's a significant amount of water. However, it doesn't help us much because we actually need a recharge rate in meters per day. More recently, the United States Geological Survey did a study, and you can access it online here. So it was done by Thomas Mack and his team. It's a very interesting report. I'd just like to highlight one or two of the findings. The first one is that the stable hydrogen and oxygen isotopic studies indicated that the groundwater in certain areas is the same as the rivers in that same area. So here, this, for example, this blue line is the Logar River, and the blue marks here, that's groundwater in the Logar area. So what it means is that the surface water is the predominant source for most of the groundwater sampled in the basins to a depth of at least 650 meters. Surface water is the source of groundwater in the Kabul River Basin. It's not so much the mountain front recharge or precipitation recharge. Most of it is coming from surface water. Another interesting fact is that most of this water is fairly young. It's all post-1950s. They also found that there was no evaporative signal in the stable isotope data. This means that the more concentrated groundwater, that means the groundwater with a higher amount of solutes, is probably because of the process of transpiration. So it's the plants in the irrigated areas and in other areas near the river which have been transpiring the water and thereby concentrating the water quality in the soil zone, which then seeps downwards to the groundwater to make it more saline. The USGS also made an interesting groundwater flow model, and they estimated that in the irrigated areas we have a recharge due to irrigation of 1.2 times 10 to the minus 3 meters per day. That basically means 1.2 millimeters per day or 438 millimeters per year. So thank you very much to the United States Geological Survey, because now we have a number which we can use for our calculations. R is 0.0012 meters per day. The next step is we need to calculate the radius of influence. Let's say that we have a circular piece of aquifer here, and our well is in the middle, pumping away. We have recharge from irrigation coming into the aquifer, and what we need to know is what is the radius of influence. So that means what radius do we need to have an area sufficiently large so that under steady state conditions our discharge from the well is the same as the recharge times by the area. In other words, the water which we extract from here is the same as the water coming into the system, and we have steady state. Now, the way we calculated it is we just take the discharge of the well divided by the recharge rate. You, of course, have to correct for seconds in the day and liters in cubic meters to reach the same units. And it comes up as 3.6 million square meters. So that's the recharge area here to sustain this well of 50 liters per second. The area of a circle is pi r squared, so we can rearrange it a bit. And we can find out what is this radius, the radius of influence R naught. It is 3.6 million square meters divided by pi, take the square root, and you find it's just over 1 kilometer. So in order to have a well pumping at 50 liters per second, we need to have a radius around it of 1 kilometer, where you don't want to have any other wells extracting water from the aquifer. So here's our conceptual model. We've just updated it with R naught. And if we want to have more than one well in our well field, we have to be careful that our radius of influence do not overlap. That means we have to place these wells at a sufficiently large distance so that they don't interfere with each other. We could put them in this square grid, as you can see here, so that they're about 2 kilometers apart, or a slightly more efficient configuration, a triangular grid, so that we don't waste any space in between the wells. Okay, question number two. What are the expected steady state drawdowns of the water table at various distances from the well? We have our R naught at 1070 meters here. And we're going to use our Dupuy-Forchheim equation, which we can write in this way, because instead of the outer radius, we're just going to use the radius of influence of the well. We can rearrange it so that we can work out what is the head at any distance from our well. And just to give you a quick example, this would be the head at 5 meters from the well. So we take here the head at the outer radius, which is 30 meters squared, minus the discharge times by log n of the radius of influence divided by 5 meters, all divided by pi and the hydraulic connectivity. It comes up at 28.74 meters, which is a drawdown of 1.26 meters. So that's this point here. Of course, we can calculate all this using our Excel spreadsheet. Here it is. And if we go down a bit, I've already entered most of these numbers, but let's say we put in 5 meters here, press the button, and here we go. Drawdown 1.256 meters. It's a bit too accurate, but it doesn't matter. And down here, we also calculate all the different values for the cone of depression using this table here. Okay, let's move on. The next question. If the area becomes urbanized, we expect that the recharge rate will drop to 10% of the precipitation, which is 330 millimeters per year. How will that affect the answers to questions 1 and 2? Okay, so here is our steady state cone of depression under the irrigated scenario. Remember, we have a radius of influence of just over a kilometer. Our discharge is 50 liters per second. Our recharge is, from the USGS estimates, 438 millimeters per year. If we urbanize it and there's no more recharge because there's no more irrigation, our radius of influence increases dramatically from about a kilometer to almost 4 kilometers. Our drawdown doesn't actually go down too much because our aquifer has got quite a high hydraulic connectivity, or should we say transmissivity. But what is really important here, and this is very important to understand, is our radius of influence has increased. So our well field design won't be appropriate anymore. Here was our original design where all the wells are happily pumping away and at equilibrium, water levels are stable. But let's have a look at one of these wells. After urbanization, it's not going to be a 1 kilometer radius, it's going to be a 4 kilometer radius. And if we take that one step further, so this is the first well, second well, third well, fourth well, another row and another row. And you can see that we have a complete overlap of areas of influence. And basically what will happen is that our water levels in this area of the aquifer will be drawn down, and groundwater will have to flow in from all sides to balance this abstraction from the well field. So if there's only one well field in a big area, maybe it doesn't matter, but if we have a lot of other wells, as we would expect in an urban area, then we might have some serious problems with aquifer overexploitation. I'd just like to end here with a few words of wisdom by Dr. Böck, who in Hanover in August 1971 wrote these words: "With any mode of groundwater exploitation, in order to secure maximum safe yield of the aquifer, provision has to be made for that recharge through irrigation by no means will be diminished." So even in 1971, equipped with just a pencil and some paper, Dr. Böck managed to reach his conclusions. And today we can see that it is still very relevant to many areas in peri-urban areas of cities where agricultural areas are being converted into urban land. It has a big influence on our water balance and a big influence on the sustainability of well fields. Okay, so I hope you found that interesting and informative, and that you learned a few things and maybe have some questions. I look forward to receiving your comments, and I hope that we meet again on the next video. Thank you very much for your attention.